let me say something else. This is Alistair Cookie. Welcome to Monsterpiece Theater. Anyway, Artemis. Okay. Not stick too many things to my groin. Let's look at a couple of the things. First of all, component-wise, these big fold-outs of charts with all the different terrain effects charts. I understand it's cheaper to put something on here than to put it on to make maps. You know, they have a nice configuration of maps, and that all makes sense to me. However, what it means is there's not room for other things that would be very, very useful. And there might be a way that you can consolidate a number of these because the terrain is essentially the same on them. Yes, there are ones where the terrain's not the same. There are ones where maybe there's a special type of thing like gardens that you don't have on some of the maps, but you do on others. So I think they could have actually consolidated this and made it a little tighter in terms of the amount of space it took up. It's already annoying as a three-piece fold-out. Much prefer a two-piece, but if you're going to do the three-piece fold-out, does this really have to be this big? I don't know. Maybe. I don't know if it needs the pictures, you know? So here's the thing. The Men of Iron series, the reason this the pictures are here is the Men of Iron series has been an easy-to-play, very light sort of game. It is slowly diverged from that. The rule book has gotten thicker. Some of that to try to nail down some of the rules, but some of that to expand the game into something more complicated that covers more types of weapon systems, etc. And obviously, as we're looking at the different transitions, that's important. There's no question of that. However, it came close to crossing a line for me with Blood and Roses, but there was a really nice feature of Blood and Roses, which was all the counters were the same. That kind of made up for something. Not every counter was the same as every other, but like all the mounted men-at-arms were exactly the same. They wanted, I guess maybe there were complaints about that, or maybe the only reason that was done that way for the War of the Roses was just sort of we really know nothing about these units. You know, we have very little information about them, whereas with the Italian Wars, as well as with the Crusades, and the couple of battles covered in the original Men of Iron, there was enough information to deal with things. But doing a whole bunch of battles on the English Civil War, well, the War of the Roses, Civil Wars, is just kind of, there are a lot of battles there that things were kind of sketchy for, so it kind of makes sense to use generic units. But anyway, why is this such a big deal that, first of all, you could have shrunk this down and used more of a GBOH type thing that was much, much smaller. This is like huge. This is like, you could put this on a easel and read it damn near. That's great for those of us with lousy eyes, but these memorize pretty quickly, maybe in part because it's so big. Other things in the rules, a couple of them, give them right here. The retreat rules as to which units can retreat through which others. The fire combat rules, which were hellish for me. I don't even want to go into the Swiss rules because there's nothing really wrong with them. There's something wrong up here, and we all know that, but for whatever reason, I just could not let, those rules just did not sink into me, and they're not complicated or anything. Anyway, the firing rules, in terms of reaction, and the specific terms, I'm not going to say, you know, there's like reaction fire, and there's another one that's got a similar word, return fire. basically there's two types of reaction fire in the system. Because of all the different weapon systems in this game, that became kind of a pain in the butt. We used up a lot of space here to give some historical analysis of the different units without really going into what their specialties were. Repeating their special rules here might have made it easier to find things. The other thing that I had to look up a lot of times was the flight points for specific units. These things, the flight points isn't so bad because it's in a chart, but it's not in the best chart presentable. You would kind of want it in something like a unit chart like this, not this big, but something that had the unit types and how much they're worth. Just a quick little chart. That would be much easier than, oh, gosh, I just lost a sword and buckler with arquebus. Well, I can't look up, so these aren't cataloged by sword and buckler by arquebus. They're cataloged by the point values. It's sort of the opposite of what you want for the lookup. You really want the unit type as the lookup, and then it tells you how many points. Not, here are all the 5-point units. It just doesn't work. Of course, this takes less space because there are multiple 5-point units, and there aren't multiple, sword and buckler with arquebus units. That would just be one entry with a number. However, a list of the units first would just make it easier, and you do it by the unit codes here. Just make a nice little chart. I'm not saying that's the only way it should be done. This wouldn't hurt as well in the rules. It's just somewhere a little chart for that. Likewise, a little chart that tells you this kind of unit can do this kind of fire this many times, some of the space that's taken up by this and by all those different terrain effects charts could have been used for that. Some of that space could have come at a cost to all these different, to this example of play that's going through, you've got multiple shock actions being worded out completely, etc. Okay, personal preference here. I don't find an extended example of play terribly helpful. The only reason I would go into that is, geez, I don't understand this game. The rules are fairly clear. The hard part is finding the things in them and remembering the things in them. So the more that the game could do in terms of reminders and easy access to all these special cases, the better it could be, or the easier it could be to play. Another problem with this one is that every scenario has basically a pile of special rules. The final scenario, the least of all of them, but it still has a couple. I'm used to these kind of not having too much in the way of special rules. This one really kind of bloats out in it, and that's been a tendency. They've been saying, all right, well, we made this, system that's generally good, but each battle has its own special peculiarities. Great, but some of them have a significant number of peculiarities to them that add heavily to the burden of actually playing them out. And I think those could have been represented perhaps in a different way, a little bit more easily. So the Swiss Pike. Honestly, if there was something that distinguished the Swiss Pike from other units a little better than the word Swiss on them, which, when I look at the counters, I don't see the name of what nationality they are. If there was, just some kind of color blast on all the Swiss units or something, that would help. It ain't there. And so I'm always, there's no mnemonic device to help remind me, oh yeah, that's a Swiss unit. There's something special about it. Of course, I have trouble sometimes distinguishing what's a pike and what's a sword and buckler, and that's something that you're really paying attention to comparatively. never paying attention to nationality, which is why I forget the Swiss all the time. Just something to give them a little bit of an extra edge that would have helped a lot. Otherwise, most of the things that I need, you know, these little charts I'm talking about and everything, those could be done with player aids that you make yourself. However, the first time you play it, you don't realize just how much of a pain in the ass playing this game is going to be without them. And so you don't make them. And the other thing is, almost each battle needs its own player aid in that case. Almost, not quite. I mean, if you devised it right, it would work fine. So I don't think that's a horrible problem. The interesting choice of the standards, that changes the game a fair amount from some of the other designs from this series. There's a lot of configuration for the battles, which is available in terms of not just the units that are there, like, oh, look, let's embed the arquebuses and the crossbows into the units. Let's not. The fact that arquebuses and crossbows aren't differentiated at all, that's a little disturbing, but maybe not so much. The reality is the rate of fire on the arquebuses was pretty damn piss poor, and their range was pretty bad. The one thing that did bother me with this was the ranges in this one have been shrunk. So this is only really important, I think, with things like the regular bows. But it has a different flavor as to what it means, the way the missile fire works in this system. In this one, if you don't want a penalty to your missile fire, you have to kind of get one hex away. If you're one hex away, they get their reaction, they get their, I don't remember which word is which, reaction fire, yeah. They get their reaction fire, which maybe it's necessary for this game to make the pike units or the infantry units with some arquebuses embedded in them capable of having the kind of defensive resilience that they did. Otherwise, bows would just pick these things apart as badly as they picked apart handgun units in Blood and Roses, and as bad as they picked apart crossbow units in the earlier two. There's definitely a few differences that are hard to kind of attribute to. Yeah, there's a reason based on the era. So, for example, the fact that armies have only one standard, that in general, that changes the pace of the battle, and I'm not sure I understand the why of it. That's the kind of thing I wish there was some designer's notes about why these choices were made instead of all this wasted crap, right? Yeah, I know, some of you like this stuff. I really don't. I believe the rules should stand on their own, more or less. Maybe with an example, a little example for something that's really kind of tricky. There's a huge book for the battle book. And part of it is there's a fairly large number of battles here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, which gives you a lot of different replay capability. There's also, each of these has, you know, a couple pages between setup and special rules. They usually have a couple pages of special rules. This one's 2.5, and it's not a very big one. And another page and a half of setup. One of the problems is the setup doesn't always match the picture on the map. From what I've been seeing in these scenarios, the picture on the map tends to, I'm guessing, is right, because you can actually fit the pieces to that. You can't fit the pieces sometimes to what's in the rulebook. There's got to be something else. Okay, so what is cool about this? First of all, the time period is just so damn interesting. And it's I was very excited about this one for that. And a little worried that, hey, Men of Iron maybe isn't complex enough to handle this. And they did add enough complexity to handle it. I'm not sure. I know when I first started this, I had the feeling of, yeah, this isn't really what I signed up for. It's not quite Musket and Pike in terms of the rules complexity. However, it's worse than that when you start adding the rules lookups for all the special cases. So, however you want to take that, the actual burden of play I found for this was towards the heavier end of the Musket and Pike games, the later Musket and Pike games as well. There's something about GMT series, like, oh, well, everybody liked this one. Let's change it and make it harder for people to like and see if they still do. So the other thing that's really interesting about this one and that I really like about it is also one of the things that feeds into some of my, you know, some of the problems that I had, which is there's all these different types of units, all this type of differentiation, and it's really showing this progression over a fairly short period of time. Basically the 1495 to 1425 period, where the weapon systems and the tactics to handle them have changed, you know, are changing significantly, moving from sort of the late Men of Iron type games, and I mean that by the first series, where, you know, infantry and pike are beginning to show, hey, we can really do something, to the counteracting the pike with the sword and buckler guys, and the counteracting the pike to some extent by starting to use large quantities of missiles, in the sense of adding the arquebuses and the crossbow. What it doesn't show is the failure of the sword and buckler. Pikes are pretty common in the battlefield. They do a better job of driving away the heavy cavalry, but they are weaker than the sword and buckler. And the real question is, I would have kind of liked to have seen why the sword and buckler style fighting as a counter to the pikes was abandoned. The way it's shown in this game, all the scenarios, it kind of trumps the pikes. And the pikes are the king of the battlefield in this. So the sword and buckler becomes the king of the battlefield. And granted, they're a little worse, significantly worse, against the heavy cav attacks. Another thing that kind of worried me was, wow, light cav, it's totally useless. No, it's not. And as we saw in the final scenario, I started using it to try to get behind units to cut off their retreat so that I would destroy units more easily. The other side of it that I had been using more earlier in the scenarios was to kind of protect my flank, to use it as screening and everything. So you have a lot of roles you can use the light cav for. It just came fun. Yeah, or it's fighting is a very abstracted sort of thing. And that works out pretty well. Other than that, it's really a matter of, this one takes a little bit more getting used to. And the fact that each scenario has its own special rules that you got to get used to. And then also has this sort of time period change that's going on, where new units are being added and old units are being withdrawn, more or less. I mean, there aren't that many unit types, but the nature of the battlefield is changing so rapidly that you kind of don't get a chance to dive in and really look at one period, except by just playing that scenario again and again. I think there's something really cool about what this is showing about that period. But I don't believe everything it's showing. So for example, that dominance of the sword and buckler units. Yeah, well, why is it everybody switched to pike, more or less? Or to Zweihanders, you know? If they wanted to cripple the pike, they got away from the sword and buckler and went to the Zweihanders to, you know, chop the pikes away and axes and stuff like that, pole axes, in order to try to counteract the advantage that what's not far from the old Macedonian style in terms of the early part this scenario handles. Anyway, this is a lot of words for something that I'm just putting on a separate wrap. As of right now, mainly because of maybe my expectations that I walked into this and I didn't like it half as much as I thought I would right at the beginning. I think we're going to do this as a full review. Just cut it out and use it for that. But mainly, I think, as the scenarios continued to play out, and I kept coming to them, it's really the lack of support elements that the game could have provided. So all the rules lookups, not being able to see the Swiss, the amount of special rules for each scenario. I didn't have that much problem with the special rules per scenario, but it did get in the way of me kind of understanding the military progression itself that was going on. These things all degraded it enough that even though this may have been quite possibly the most interesting period for me to want a game, and I'm talking previous to even thinking about this, the Italian Wars, I've had a great deal of interest in, and the wars of that same period, I've had a lot of interest in across the board before this. So I was very excited about it, but I think this one is, for me, the weakest of the series, and maybe a little bit of effort in putting together some play aids, and it could be the strongest, but I'm just having way too much difficulty actually playing it correctly without pawing through the rules, you know, on every couple activations to try to find something out. Whatever it is, the point values for units or the firing opportunities or the retreat rules, and those things don't stick well when you keep changing the rules because of scenario-specific rules as well, when you keep adding that burden on. I mean, it's just, at least for me, it was really troublesome. There were also some things with the gunfire, and I kind of felt this about the Blood and Roses as well, that these artillery pieces especially, they felt like they weren't really terribly effective, but they could be, which is to say, in scenarios where the artillery was kind of the same as another command, it worked really well. But when it was segmented into its own, because of the way activations work in this game, it didn't have as good an effect. Is that part of the configuration? Is that the intent? Does it make sense? I don't know. It's hard to understand what the intention behind, yeah, let's lump these all together in the same battle is. And I feel like with the last couple games in the series, and the introduction of the artillery especially, and this one especially, because gunfire is so important here, Blood and Roses is less important. I think that the command system is just not holding up to display this era as well as maybe trying to take Musket and Pike and working it backwards, maybe giving some different values to units. Change some of the fire charts and stuff a little bit to weaken and to show that lesser effect that the firepower had. I think that might be a better option because this command system just is not doing it in the same way. It seems to work okay with the lack of command and control that existed in some of the medieval battles. It feels like you're it just feels like it's not able to represent what's going on as well as I would want things to show. Obviously we're not in the full the full Gustavus era, but I think you can represent that with crappier leaders in the Musket and Pike better than with this kind of, the battle only happened on one part of the field or something like that, which tends to happen in this game, in the whole series. Anyway, this one was a little bit disappointing, but maybe if I come back to it in a few years, make those charts, maybe it'll be not quite as bad. Will it still be the worst? Probably. I think it's stretching the era too much, to tell you the truth. All right, let's send it on.